Welcome back to the second part of our creature sculpting series. If you've just tuned in, make sure to watch the first part. You can find the link in the video description. In this part, we will finish the primary shape of our creature. You will learn additional sculpting tools like the pose brush, masking and trimming, how to work best with reference images, and the power of curves. In the last video, we stopped with the sculpt of the rough shape of our creature with a low resolution. And before we go any further, I should give you some information about the rest position. If you are planning to animate or pose your model later, you should to leave enough space between different parts. The reason is that first, sculpting otherwise becomes quite difficult between the parts, and second, the weighting of the bones of the later rig becomes difficult to handle. You may have wondered why human characters always stand in such a strange resting pose, namely the A or T pose. This is why. If you notice during sculpting that you need more distance, you can always use the pose brush to reposition your model. The pose brush works similar to the bones of your later rig. Just select it, choose a suitable radius, and use it like any other brush. Let's spread the legs of our creature a little now and continue with the overall shape. In order to refine the shape more and more, we have to increase the resolution more and more. So let's use Blender's remesh function with a smaller voxel size. But not too small. Take a brush of your choice and continue to work on your model. I've taken a voxel size of about 0.02, but you may find another one best for you. And don't forget, you can use the remesh function over and over to fix your mesh. If you've reached a point where the voxel size is no longer sufficient, this is exactly right. Just move to another spot and continue there. Yeah, so basically the only thing I do here is add, smooth, drag, smooth, add, smooth, drag, 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 drag. Now let's continue with the head. I like to use the draw sharp brush to make marks on my model as if it were a pencil. As an example, here I sketch the shape of the later mouth. And for the rest, you already know, drag smooth, add smooth, drag smooth. Oh, and by the way, I still do not use a graphics tablet, just the mouse. And so far, I don't use any reference images because it is only the rough silhouette. At this point, I only want to establish the effect of the creature, big and dangerous. I still do not know how the creature will look later. And now to a tool that changed my life.
The tool that has increased my sculpting skills 100-fold since I started using it. The tool that brings entire pandemics down to their knees. The tool over which even films have been made.
Masking is marking vertices to prevent them from being manipulated during sculpting. To mask certain areas, you can use the mask brush with the hotkey M and paint on your model. You can also use box mask, or with control and hold on the icon, you can select the lasso mask or the line mask. By opening the mask menu, you can smooth, sharpen, grow, invert, remove the mask, and whatever. I would advise you to integrate masking into your workflow very early to get used to it quickly. It will be worth it. In case of the eye sockets, the mask helps me to find the right position. And when you invert the mask, you can use the mesh filter or any other brush to dig a hole. Let's clear the mask and create a UV sphere as an eyeball, and then place it in the right position as eyes with a mirror modifier. And finally adjust the eye sockets to the eyes. I will now also use the mask tool to make the legs longer. And a combination of the lasso mask and the pose brush helps me to create the mouth. You can cut a hole using the lasso trim tool. Use Blender's remesh function and use the already known tools to form a nice shape for the mouth. And now it's time to get more specific. Until now, I only knew that my creature should be a mix of a fish and a rhinoceros. And I only knew how it should appear to others, dangerous, powerful. Now we have to illustrate exactly these characteristics not only through the silhouette, but also through smaller details. And since we humans are by no means walking cameras, nor do we have an unlimited portfolio of creativity, we have to help ourselves. Even great artists like Da Vinci knew the power of Pinterest and Instagram in their search for inspiration for their artwork. In any kind of art, whether on canvas or digital, artists use references. Using references is discovering details on images or in real life to give the artist a better understanding of the object they are painting or modeling. I would even go so far to say that the quality of the reference images has a 50% impact on the result. So you should take enough time to look for reference images for each of your projects. The easiest way to work with reference images is to use the free software called PureRef. Here you can create a canvas and drag in your images from Pinterest or Google Images. As a small tip, look at macro shots. This can bring your creativity or modeling to the next level. For this creature, I mainly use references from reptiles. The head shape, the structure, etc. are strongly inspired by them. For the anatomy, I mainly stick to a rhinoceros. By that I mean visible muscles, skin and so on. Other than that, it's just try and error, just sculpt and see what looks good. Now let's create some spikes. Add a cylinder, scale it, add some loop cuts, and block out an interesting shape with the editing tools you already learned in the first video. Bring it in position and duplicate it a bunch of times along the back of the creature. When you now try to form a smooth curve using proportional editing, you will quickly reach your limits. The topology will be a mess, it is no longer evenly thick, and the whole process is just not comfortable. We need another way. Let me introduce you the beautiful world of curves. Curves can be used to create a smooth path to deform a mesh along. You can create a curve like any other object with a press on Shift A. There are two types of curves. What type you use is up to you. I prefer Bezier curves. In the object data properties, you can give the curve geometry. Curves are also often used to create hair or animate an object like a camera along a path. With this new knowledge, let's take one of the spikes and reset the rotation. Press Shift A to create a curve, scale it to the size of the spike and bring it in the same position. And now, and this is very important, right-click and set the origin to 3D cursor. Your curve has to be here and the origin, so the orange dot, exactly here. If you've messed up your 3D cursor, you can simply bring it back by pressing Shift S and select Cursor to World Origin. On your spike, you can now add a subdivision surface modifier to increase the number of polys, and after that, add a curve modifier. Select your previously created curve and the correct deform axis in the modifier. And when you go into edit mode of the curve now, you should be able to move the different dots and the spike should adjust to the form of the curve. This is tough sometimes, since every little piece has to be done correct in order for it to work. So, make sure the rotation is applied on your mesh, the origin is correctly set on the curve, the correct deform axis is selected in the modifier, and if it still does not work, delete the curve and start over again. When you finally manage to do it, delete the old spikes. Now move the curve together with the spike in position, duplicate both as often as you need, and start forming the spikes to create an interesting shape. As for the teeth, I will do the same as for the spikes, but this time I will use proportional editing to make a little curve. Add a mirror modifier and add as many teeth as you need. Move them, scale them, rotate them, just create enough randomness to make it interesting. And lastly for the tail, for which I will use a curve again. Alright, so far we've gone through the process of blocking out our basic shape to a state where we can even see the creature come to life. In the next video, we will finish the final shape of our creature and start the preparation for the final detailing process. If you need to watch the videos in real-time speed, I'm uploading all my raw videos to my Patreon page. And in addition, you can download sculpting textures instead of buying them somewhere else and have access to all my Blender projects. So make sure to check it out. See you in the next part.